Hello, 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 everybody. We are coming to you from fabulous Palm Springs. I'm Linda. This is...
Carl.
Who is this? This is Carl. And we are Colourwerx Designs. It is Friday, August 26th, and it's time for another fabulous episode of... My goodness, welcome, welcome,
exciting.
Welcome in, everybody. So yes, it's Friday, August 26th. Again, we're coming to you from fabulous Palm Springs where it is hot and it is humid. That's why we have our sun up there taking a little cocktail in. It's been very humid. We're in monsoon season here in the desert. Thankfully, I think it's subsiding finally. Look who's checking in. Let's see who's checking in. Please make sure that you like and share this video with friends. Again, algorithms are changing out there on Facebook, so, and also Instagram. And so if you don't engage, you don't see our posts. Let's put it that way. So good morning, Lena. And good morning, April, and Barbara, and Julie. Good morning to you all and anybody else who's out there being kind of in the shadows, so to speak. And I can't blame you for that anyway. So this is episode 51 of our Fab Friday program. We have a great tutorial for you today about prepping your machine applique shapes and doing overlay sheets and all that other stuff. But I wanted to let you in on a couple things. We're doing a giveaway today. And we've got two prizes for a giveaway. Now, all you have to do is leave a comment in the comment section. So if you're watching this on replay on the Colourwerx YouTube channel or on the Facebook, you have until September 1st. And if you're here live with us, then of course, if you've commented, you already have put an entry in to win one of these two great things we have. So we have, first prize is Krista Watson's newest quilt book, which is called How Do I Quilt It? She sent us an extra copy. It's a wonderful how-to machine quilt book where she gives you a bunch of different ideas about how to machine quilt your quilts. She also signed it for you right there on the cover. So if you don't want to wait until the contest is over in order to get maybe a chance to win this book, you can go to Krista's website, which is KristaQuilts.com, and actually purchase her book right up there on her website. But that's one of two door prizes. The other one is this one, which is Block Magazine. That's Jenny with our quilt, Color Go Round. She's holding it there. We're the featured designer in this issue of Block Magazine. There it is, woo! And so that's the other door prize. I shouldn't say door prize. It's actually a prize
giveaway.
And so we have two giveaways this week. Just leave us a comment. The contest is open till September 1st, and then we'll announce with our random thingamagizer who won each of these books. And so that's the news on giveaways. We also have news. Anybody else checking in? Oh, April goes, oh, I'd love those. Look at that. And good morning, Lisa. I just saw you check in as well. So update on the house. I think we can go to that slide, right, Carl?
Yeah.
So we have been under the cover of plastic, if you will, for the last week and a half. Our painter, we finally got him in. It was great. He did a really great job. We have taken the house now into a cool gray white, which is really nice. It's like an icy white. We had this in our other condo as well. We went through a myriad of paint chips here. And we just decided to go back to the older paint color because it allows colors to pop. So we have our painter in. We are now sitting in a beautifully painted condo here with the exception of the kitchen, which we're going to redo.
And the floor.
And the, well, I'm getting to that. And the floor. And that's our winter project. So we're going to be doing the vinyl planking floor throughout the entire 1,500 square feet, Carl and I, like we did in our other condo. So that's our winter project. So we'll be probably on our hands and knees for, what, 2 months, I guess?
Forever.
Clinking in vinyl planking floor. So we're going to start back in the office in the sewing room, and we'll post pictures of that for you as well. We also have a new front door, in case you didn't see this. We got a, we treated ourselves when we moved in here to a little, like, housewarming gift, which was this great atomic mid-mod welcome sign. And so we decided to have the painter, while he was here, paint the door to match the sign. We have a little video on that, too.
Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our...
I remember where they came and everything was true when we would have such a very good time, such a fine time.
Yes, so you can see that. And so now, we were going to paint the door kind of an acid green, and I know there were a lot of you guys out there that were acid green fans, as I was one, but you know, the orange won out because the sign had to match the door and vice versa, and it's very Palm Springs and all that other stuff. So anyway, that's the update on the Colourwerx Dezign Haus. We're also in the middle of redesigning the kitchen, and so we're going to be posting some, I don't know, some ideas that we have going on. We've kind of gotten some samples of tiles in. We're looking at some new cabinetry in some great kind of mid-mod colors. So we'll actually post those for you guys to look at as well. Okay, anybody else checking in? Hi, Pam. I just noticed you checked in. And Joy. And April says, better get some knee pads. I was like, oh, yes. I think we have to dig those out of storage somewhere.
Mary from Margaret City.
Oh, hi, Mary. How are you? So it's great to have everybody here again. So let's see. I have an update in the shop before we get to the tutorial, too. So we've just added this beautiful bundle in the shop, Deco Glow. And I wanted to highlight this for you. This is designed by our friend Giuseppe, otherwise known as Juicy Juice. That would be G-I-U-C-Y on Instagram. And he works with Andover Fabrics. It's a beautifully bright, and I mean super bright bundle, and it's 10 fat quarters or 10 half yards. So we have it in both fat quarters, half yards, but it's 10 fabrics in all. I'm gonna be making a labyrinth quilt, I think, with this, or a mod box, I don't know. But I haven't quite decided, but that is new to the shop. We also have, still in the shop, beautiful Cheers Batiks. Now, this is the line that Carl and I designed for Island Batiks. So we have strip packs and 10-inch squares, but we can show you the fabric that's coming in as well in September. So this is the fabric line that Carl and I designed for Island Batiks. It'll be hitting shops in September. It'll be hitting the Colourwerx shop, hopefully, mid-September. So you can buy yardage. We'll have fat quarter bundles and half yard bundles, and we'll be kitting a lot of our quilts with it as well. But we also have right now in stock the strip packs and the 10-inch squares. And if we go to that next slide, I think you'll see you can actually make the paint box quilt now or the color maze quilt. So those are both strip friendly, and you would just need one strip pack to do either one of those quilts. But also, you can see in the middle, the new Cheers cocktail quilt. I'm happy to report that that is at the printers. We're expecting our copies or copies for you to arrive here at the Dezign Haus anytime, hopefully by Labor Day. So make sure you keep your ears perked to your email, because I think we might, right, Carl, do a little Labor Day sale on our patterns, which may include the Cheers pattern debuting at a special price or discount for you as well. But that is super fun, and that is all the news coming out of the house at this point, I think, right?
Yes.
Okay. So if you guys are ready, I think we're ready to start our tutorial on applique shapes and actually prepping those shapes. I'm waiting for Carl to go back to the master camera here and to the overhead. Where are we going, Carl?
Master.
Okay. So I'm going to head over to the overhead now, just to really, there you go. And we're going to talk about prepping applique shapes, unless anybody has any quick burning questions about anything else that we've done so far. So this is what you're looking at here. Here I am with the overhead. What you're looking at is my working pattern when we make our samples here in the shop. So that's why it looks a little different. This is block 3, the martini glass of our Cheers pattern. I thought this would be a great one to use about prepping your applique shapes and coming up with a stitching plan and also doing overlay sheets. And we'll get into what all that means in just a minute. So this looks a little strange, only in the sense that when we print out our working patterns here at the Dezign Haus, we print them out because our printer is only capable of printing 8.5 by 11 sheets. So we have to print the pattern full scale and then tape together 4 or 5 sheets to make our pattern full size. This is not what you would be getting in the Cheers pattern. You will actually be getting in the Cheers pattern, and this is a working prototype from our printer, a 3-foot by 4-foot huge pattern that you unfold, and then you can cut apart all the blocks, and each of the shapes are numbered, and it looks very professional because it is. So this is the actual pattern that you will be getting. But I'm going to use my working pattern here of the martini glass as my sample today to go through the tutorial. So when you start to prep your shapes, the first thing that you need to determine is if the pattern is printed in reverse or if it's printed as it should appear once the shapes are complete and fused to your background block. And what I mean by that is a lot of times designers will actually say to you in the pattern, for instance, we do it right here, block three martini, shapes are already reversed. Why do our shapes reverse? Well, because we're doing fusible web machine applique. And what happens with fusible web machine raw edge applique is that you actually draw your shapes on the fusible web. We'll get to that in just a moment. And then you fuse those to the wrong side of the fabric that you want the shape to be, which means when you cut the shape out, the shape is actually has to be reversed when you trace it, so that when you cut the shapes out and turn the fabric to the right side, the shape is facing the right way. If you think of doing letters, like in the initial L, you would have to trace the initial L in the opposite or reverse direction. So that's the first thing you have to determine when you get a new applique pattern at home is this pattern already reversed, or do I need to reverse it in order to trace my shapes using the raw edge machine applique technique? Since our patterns are already reversed, you don't need to worry about that. But let's say I needed to reverse this pattern you're looking at. Well, there's a couple easy ways to do that. One, this is the pattern that may come out of your pattern book. You can use a light box, like is what I have here on the table here. And this is just a light tracing table or a light box that you get at Amazon or an art store. And again, I would take the printed side of the pattern and I would just simply turn it to the back side where the blank page is and then start to actually draw or trace the pattern again. That will put the pattern in reverse. That would be the side that I would use to trace my shapes with. If I don't have a light box at home, I can simply just tape this pattern, if I needed to reverse it, this is only if you need to reverse it, up in a window with the blank side facing me, and do the same thing. The light coming through the window will actually illuminate, just like the light box does, the lines coming through so you can see them. So that's the first thing. Determine if you need to reverse the pattern. Since you might be working with a Colourwerx pattern, you don't need to reverse it. It's already been reversed for you, and you're ready to start tracing your shapes. So how do we do that? We'll just do a quick overview on that. I like to use heat and bond light. This is the heat and bond light fusible iron-on adhesive. If you want to use steam-a-seam for your fusible web, you can do that. If you want to use Pellin Wonder Under for your fusible web, you can do that. Any of those fusible webs work. I happen to like heat and bond light, not because I'm an influencer, it's only because it's reliable. And what you need to do is you start to trace all your shapes, they need to be reversed, of course, on the fusible web. But if I use this as my sample, here's my martini glass, and I want to show you how I've traced these shapes. Notice that on the pattern, and many times you'll find this on other patterns, the olive, the swizzle stick, and the reflection here that's shaded, they're all in place or overlapping each other. When you do fusible web applique, you have to actually trace all those shapes independently of each other on the fusible web. And I'm tracing on the smooth side of the fusible web. There's a bumpy side and a smooth side to this fusible web. Notice that I've traced them all independently. Also, look at those swizzle sticks. Do you see that little note I've made to myself saying quarter inch? Well, you have to take note of that also in your patterns, unless the pattern designer gives you that information. So if we look at this swizzle stick here, the first thing we have to notice is the top part of the swizzle stick is overlapped by the martini glass. So even though my pattern's not indicating any dotted lines there, which would indicate that it's being overlapped, I need to add a quarter inch seam allowance to that shape when I draw it, the top swizzle stick shape, so that I have a quarter inch seam allowance beyond the shape to tuck under the martini glass. So if that pattern you're using doesn't give you the dotted lines, and we do, let me show you our master pattern. Can you see shape 7 there? And see the swizzle stick? It's got dotted lines that go under the martini glass there. That shows you that you need to add that to your shape number 7. That is over. That shape is overlapped by the martini glass. So if your pattern doesn't show you that, you need to add those on. And again, every shape is independent of another because they're all going to be different fabrics. Once you get all your shapes traced, and I would actually also add that please use a pencil to trace your shapes. A lot of people come in here with a Sharpie and trace their shapes, and I can tell you from past experiments, when you use a Sharpie, sometimes if you need to use fray check on the edge of your applique shape, the Sharpie will actually bleed. There's some reaction that goes on between felt tip pens and fray check or some glues that causes the ink to bleed into your fabric. So always use like a number 2 pencil or a mechanical pencil.
No Frixion either.
No Frixion. Don't use Frixion pens because, of course, once you iron the shape on to your fabric, you'll lose your lines. So the next thing you do once you have traced your shapes independently of each other is you're going to actually then fuse them to the wrong side of a fabric. You're going to want to rough cut out these shapes, and I have a sample of that. A lot of people get confused. What does rough cut mean? Well, let me show you. Rough cut means that you're simply going to, here's my fabric, you're simply going to rough cut the shape out of the fusible web. You're leaving about a quarter inch to a half inch of fusible web beyond the drawn line. This does not have to be an exact cut, but you don't need a lot of fusible web to go with you to the backside of the fabric. Now you might be asking, what's going on here in the middle of this martini glass? Well, this is just something to keep in mind. I don't do this a lot, but a lot of people don't like the buildup of shape upon shape upon shape of fusible web because they feel like it stiffens their block. So you might want to donut hole out the center of your shapes. And donut hole out means, you can see my line there of the martini glass, I've just simply cut out the middle of the glass, leaving myself about a half inch of fusible web inside the line. One of the reasons I don't like to do this too much is because I really don't like my shapes to shift on me while I'm stitching. And I find by donut holing out, my shapes shift. I don't know what it is. So you may choose to do this. I just don't actually practice this too much, but I wanted to show you that. Once you get your shape rough cut out, you iron it to the wrong side of the fabric you wish the shape to be. And then now you're ready, once you iron it to the wrong side, to take a nice pair of precision scissors, something that's about a 4 to 5 inch blade, and cut right on the line to create your shape. This is where you want to be perfect with your cutting and take your time cutting the shapes out. Once your shapes are all prepared, you're ready to start stitching. But wait, there's more. So you might want to create for yourself an overlay sheet. I talk about overlay sheets quite a lot. What's an overlay sheet? Well, an overlay sheet is simply a guide of the master pattern to tell you where to place shapes on your background fabric or your background block. So this is the background to the martini glass. In order to create my overlay sheet, I need to go back to my master pattern that came with the pattern itself, which is this. And Carl's showing you something on the screen there. So that is the martini block as it, the what's on the left side is the martini block as it would appear when it's complete. Notice the martini glass is on the right side. My master pattern, because it's already been reversed, the martini glass is on the left side. So in order to create an overlay sheet, I need to again go back to reversing the using the other side of my pattern, and I simply take a non-fusible interfacing known as pattern ease, or I can use tracing paper, or I can use clear vinyl that I get at Walmart, anything that I can draw on. Some people use just Xerox paper, and I like the pattern ease, and I'll tell you in a moment why. But you take your whatever you're going to make your overlay sheet out of, and you just simply put it over the master pattern, and ooh, there was my head, and then you just trace it. This is as the block would appear. So you don't want to trace shapes independently like we did with the with the shape building, you want to trace the block as it would appear when all the shapes are in place. Again, this is going to create a guide for you of where to place your shapes. Once you've got your overlay pattern, your overlay sheet created, and I did this with just a felt tip marker on here because I'm not worried about bleeding if I hit, I'm not going to hit this with fray check. Then you can staple the overlay sheet, whatever it's made out of, on top of your background block. And now this just tells me where to place. Let's say I had the martini glass done and I wanted to know exactly where to place it. I just lift the overlay sheet up. I place my shape underneath there in place. And then I would either iron right through this overlay sheet, which is one of the reasons I like this product, Patternese, which we're actually going to start carrying, I think, in our Colourwerx shop. But because Patternese allows you to iron right through it without burning. But if you were using a piece of paper, tracing paper, or even a piece of clear vinyl that you might have, then you would just simply place your shape under there, get it in place, and then just roll the overlay sheet out of the way and fuse your shape into place. So overlay sheets are very important because if you have several shapes, it allows you to be more exact than having to eyeball the pattern back and forth. That's one of the big things about overlay sheets. Next thing is shapes and pre-stitching. So one of the things you have to look at when you get your pattern is, are there possibilities, when you look at your pattern, to set up smaller shapes on top of larger shapes and pre-stitch those before they actually go on the background block? I do a lot of pre-stitching, and if you look at this martini glass, you're going to see a couple things going on. Notice that the swizzle stick that comes through the olive right here, I've actually already put it in place, and I've actually pre-stitched that, all right? I've actually done that too with this little reflection down here. This is the reflection you see right here. Now remember, this is in reverse, and this is the way it comes out when it's done. Okay, so you might be saying, well, what are these little, what's all this? What's going on here on the side, Linda? Well, this is stabilizer. And again, what I've done here by pre-stitching is I've actually, very important, left the release paper on the back side of the martini glass. So I removed the release paper from the swizzle stick. I ironed it in place. I stitched around it. When I got to this little kidney shape, I was having a really hard time maneuvering the needle around that little shape, only holding on to the stem of the glass. So what I did is I just got into the trash can and took a couple pieces of stabilizer and just slapped them to the back. Now the stabilizer I like to use is Sulky Iron-On Crisp Tearaway Stabilizer. And so this gives me some handles, if you will, to maneuver the glass around stitching. I would just, when I get ready to put this under on the background block, I'm just gonna like tear away, like that, the stabilizer. And then I would take the release paper off and fuse that to my background block. I also did it with like these building shapes that are right here. So you can see the building shapes have a, if we go to the main photo, Carl will show you that, where this goes into place. The building shapes that are on the left-hand side of the block have this little inner reflection here. And so why not set those up by stitching those in place prior to fusing that huge piece to your background block? It just makes a little bit easier to maneuver a little piece like this under your needle versus a big 16-inch block that you have to squish and everything put through. You also might say, well, what is this going on? Again, this is stabilizer from the trash can. And because the inner reflection of the building starts and stops way down here at the bottom of the building, I was having a really hard time getting the zigzag started. So I needed to create myself like a little leader piece. So I just put a piece of stabilizer down there. And again, when the time comes to actually put this on my background block, I just tear away that stabilizer. And I tear away all the release paper from the fusible web on the back and fuse it to my block, and I'm ready to go. So you can set up any of as much of these smaller pieces, and I would suggest that you do that and stitch around them before you start actually stitching them to your main background block. And the reason being for that too, like this martini glass, I would go in and probably put in this inner reflection of the glass or of the martini, whatever that is, that Carl designed there, and stitch around it. And I would actually put in the olive as well. So I would set it completely up on this martini glass, stitched, ready to go, then tear away all the release paper, and then using my overlay sheet, take the martini glass and stick it in place. And then all I would need to do at that point is stitch around the green part of the martini shape. So I hope that helps. Those are some little tips and tricks to get you started on your applique. A lot of it is just kind of taking a moment to actually come up with a game plan when you're looking at that pattern and making sure that you can actually make your stitching as easy as possible for yourself. The other thing I would add is a lot of people, and I see this in class, will have all their shapes prepared and then they want to remove all the release paper right away and they want to fuse everything into place right away and then start stitching. I would caution you against that. Why? Because if you fuse everybody in place, all the shapes, you're going to be squishing this in your machine. You know, we all squish it up under the throat of the machine and every which way to get the stitching perfect. Once you start doing that, you're going to find that all your shapes are going to start to lift away from the background block. So I tend to do it very methodically and do it as many setups as I can, meaning putting smaller shapes on tops of larger shapes. And then I will just start, like if I was going to start this block, I would probably start with the straw first right here, which is what I did on the main block. If you see, there's the straw. And I would start with that straw first because he's overlapped by the martini glass. I would then set up my whole martini glass, put that in place, and then I would fuse on the buildings, and last would be the moon. And I would do it in that sequence, fuse and then stitch and then fuse and stitch, so that the shapes would not lose their fusible web on the back and things would not start lifting on me. So with that, I'm going to go back to my place. I hope that helps you guys set up your appliques a little bit better. Again, it's all in the prep, you know. And if there's any questions, we can take those now. Carl will let me know as I move myself back into position here and let me know if you have any questions. Let's see. Fantastic tips, April says. Anybody?
Oh, already mirrored.
Yes. Yeah, we do that with a lot of our applique patterns. We will already put them in reverse. So that's something to keep in mind when you get an applique pattern. Check to make sure if it's already in reverse. Again, if it's not, it's super easy to put it in reverse, like I said, by either, you know, taking the page and putting it on your light box, your tracing box, or in the window. I used to do that quite a lot in Virginia, tape things up in the window because it was very bright and things like that. The other option, if you don't have a really bright window, is to actually take a glass coffee table, if you have a glass top to something, and just put a flashlight under it, and that will create a light box for you right away. So those are some just big tips there.
Maybe we should talk about numbering too.
Well, I mean, on all of our designs, again, this is the prototype from our printer with some notes up here. You won't get these notes, but we number all of our patterns for you too, and we give you the numerical sequence we think you should place your shapes on and stitch. That's just another tip too, that if you have a pattern, you can sit and number them for the numerical sequence that you want to put your shapes down. But always start with the shape that is closest to the background fabric. So that would be the shape that is either overlapped by everybody else or shapes that are overlapped by other shapes, etc., or that it's closest to the background fabric. Who else? Oh, Julie says, I've never used patternese until working on your tiki. It made aligning pieces much easier. It is. Patternese is a wonderful product, and I don't know why we never brought it in the shop, but I'm actually considering bringing it in the shop at this point because I think people are having a little bit of a hard time finding it. Mary says, very helpful tips. I like the idea of patternese. Thank you. Yes, as far as I know, patternese is at the Joann's Fabrics, and some quilt stores do carry it. So with that, I think we're ready to move on. We do have, oh wait, what's Lisa saying? Wait, Lena, have to get back to work. We'll watch you right. Yes, bye, Lena. Have a great day.
And Lisa
says, I love these tips. I've been doing machine applique for years, and some of these are new to me. Well, that is great. Thank you, Lisa. I like hearing comments like that. You know, I think we're always learning, so that's always good. I do have an announcement now as we come to near the end of our Fab Friday. So we are going to get back into doing quilt alongs. In case you don't know it, we do have another Facebook page called Colourwerx Quilt Alongs. And on that, it's really a group page. You can join. Everybody's welcome. You just go look for it on Facebook. But if you've been to our website under Fun Stuff, I have all of the past quilt alongs there. And we've done 8 quilt alongs on a variety of our patterns. And so each one of these quilt alongs either have blog posts or video tutorials to go with them, or both. And you're welcome to just view those all. They're up there 24/7. You can jump into any quilt along at any time. But we're going to start a new quilt along finally. It's been quite a while. And so the new quilt along is Maud Blossom. That's why it's here behind me. Yes, so we are going to do Maud Blossom. I think this would be a fun quilt to do for the new quilt along starting September 26th. I'll be coming out with new with materials lists, things that you need to gather. It's going to be super, super simple unless you want to do the full-on lap quilt, which is what you see on your screen. I rendered it in Krista Watson's great new collection called Stitchy, and she was so nice to send us, I have to get to the overhead now, her fabric line. There it is. So her company sent me a fat quarter bundle of her new fabric line, Stitchy, which is coming to her shop in October. But it's a great little fabric line full of color by Krista Watson at KristaQuilts.com. And the new quilt along is Maud Blossom, coming back to that. It's going to be super fun. What we're going to do is we're actually going to make one of each block. We're going to make a leaf block and we're going to make a flower block. I'll go to the overhead so Carl can show you. There's the flower block, and voila, there's the leaf block. And these are super, super fabric efficient blocks. So 2 fat quarters will make you one of each block. And then you add extra fat quarters in to do the cornerstones in the flower block. And you add extra fat quarters or scraps in to do the centers of those blocks, where it looks like you've got a square and a square, or you've got like a pinwheel going on in those leaf blocks. And so it's probably going to be about a 3 to 4 week quilt along, pretty easy going. I'll have more announcements coming soon, but that quilt along will start September 26. And if you like the Stitchy fabric, I would urge you to go over to KristaQuilts.com and see if you can pre-order, see if you can email her about it. I think the fabrics are coming out in October. So that is news on the quilt along. Last, don't forget, all your comments today will enter you in to win one of these 2 great big door prizes. How Do I Quilt It by Krista Watson, or the Block magazine where we're featured on the front cover. All you have to do is comment there. And if you're watching a replay of the Fab Friday program, which I hope you are, you can comment on YouTube, or you can still comment on the Facebook page up till September 1st, 2022, when we're going to shut the comments down and pick a winner at that point. Anybody else checking in, Carl? Anything else going on? Let's see. April says, such a fun pattern, never used patterning, but sounds great. Thank you, April. Okay. All right. So here we go. We're going to check out of here for the weekend. We hope that you're having a great weekend and that you're quilting up something super fun and super colorious. We'll be back with you on September 23rd. I'm looking at my notes with another tutorial. And with that, we thank you guys so much for checking in today. We're going to wish you a happy weekend and happy colorious quilting always. Mwah!
Bye.
Bye.